Bible reading, a reading from the book of Psalms, chapter 126, verses 2 and 3. Our mouths were filled with laughter, our tongues with singing. Then they said among the nations, "The Lord has done great things for them. The Lord has done great things for us, and we are glad." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Prayer. Our dear Father in heaven, thank you for your never-ending love, grace, guidance, and divine providence in all through the years of the Department of English. At this juncture, with thanksgiving heart, we have organized a 9-day webinar series titled A Literary Cornucopia. Our Father, the Alpha and the Omega, be with us and provide us wisdom to complete the webinar series with the spirit of your never-ending and everlasting love. Enlighten us through the resource persons with the plethora of knowledge. Let this webinar be a fruitful one for all who have joined with us in oneness of heart. This we ask in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Small cheer and great welcome make a merry feast. Professor Alpha Nirmala, the head of the Department of English, to welcome the gathering.
Pleasant good evening to everyone present in the virtual gathering. Respected chief guest, reverend sisters, distinguished professors, teaching fraternity from around the world, and vibrant young aspiring minds. I welcome you all to celebrate the joy of intellectual feast with us in connection with the 50th year of the Department of English. The department has experienced numerous success throughout its 50-year journey. We are proud to be a part of this great prestigious institution which had celebrated the Golden Jubilee last year in a grand manner. Even though we are thousands of miles apart, we are united today in the true sense of sustaining and reinvigorating higher education by commencing a literary cornucopia, the Golden Jubilee webinar series. Sustaining and reinvigorating higher education has become a major challenge, especially in pandemic era. On behalf of the management, it is my honor to welcome Dr. Samuel Rufus, who always strive to enlighten the young minds with noble vision. I sincerely believe that the resource person of the inauguration of the webinar series is a God-given treasure to unveil the literary pleasure in us. From the depth of our hearts, we welcome you, sir. At the heart of the department's accomplishment lies the strong foundation laid under the tutelage of two great people, our principal, Sister Aisrani, our secretary, Sister Queensley Tainty. Their constant support increases strength in us day by day, despite the COVID dilemma in organizing the Golden Jubilee events. I feel elated to welcome the president of the inauguration, our principal, who is the driving force of any conception of education in our institution. We express our warm welcome, sister. I deem it a pleasure to welcome our secretary, Sister Queensley Jainty, who remains a blessing forever, cascading as a shooting star for every success of us. We extend a pleasant welcome, sister. The dream of organizing the webinar series is materialized by the coordinator and conveners who have been adding value to the department and bringing success. I welcome them all in a special way. We extend a warm welcome to the well-wishers of Jera Chennapakyam College. Your presence here brings much joy to all of us. We would like to convey our heartfelt welcome to all the participants of Google Meet and YouTube channel. We gratefully recognize your positions from registrants to attendees, which establish your persistent interest in participating in the webinar series. I once again welcome you all on reaching this Golden Jubilee milestone. May you continue to support for all the webinars to come. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am, for the charming welcome address. With resonance of joy in our hearts, we, the Department of English, feel proud to inaugurate our webinar series. I'm glad to welcome Mrs. Angeline Sorna, Assistant Professor of English, the coordinator of the program, to introduce the webinar series. Welcome, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am. A warm good evening to all. I deem it a privilege to provide a brief introduction to the webinar series and the Golden Jubilee of the department. When founded in 1971, Jairaj Anapakyam College for Women Periyakulam was the first women's college in this area. And for half a century now, the college has taken upon itself the colossal social responsibility of providing quality higher education to rural women. The English department of JSE had its inception in 1972, and since then have worked tirelessly in molding young women who are powerful communicators and creative thinkers who can live a meaningful life and facilitate transformative pathways for community at large. This year, 2022, marks the Golden Jubilee of the department, and we are planned to commemorate the special year with a number of programs, and this webinar series is the first of them all. It was decided that this webinar series doesn't have to contain itself to a theme, but would be a literary cornucopia, a real horn of plenty. And we are truly delighted to present this abundant literary feast, which brings you 9 valuable plenaries, delivered by some of the best resources on a variety of relevant and contemporary topics. Something very special about this webinar is that each of the webinars of the series has its own convener and organizing secretary. And it has been a true team effort of the department under the guidance of a head of a department, Dr. Patricia Alfin Nirmala. The participants can attend the talks they are interested in, and certificates shall be provided individually for each webinar. We eagerly anticipate your continued cooperation, support, and patronage. Wishing you all an intellectually enriching time ahead. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am, for an amiable and brief introduction to the event. The greatest leader is the one that gets the people to do the great things. With a joyful spirit and mirthful heart, I welcome our dear Sister Secretary and Mother Superior, Dr. Sister B.J. Queensley Jayanti, to deliver her felicitations. Welcome, Sister.
Warm greetings and salutations to you all. It is with great pleasure that I wholeheartedly welcome our resource person for the day, Dr. Samuel Rufus, Associate Professor of English, Madras Christian College, Chennai. I take this moment to extend my heartfelt gratitude to this esteemed personality who has accepted our invitation to preside over this webinar session on the title A Literary Cornucopia. Moving forward, I would like to extend a warm welcome to our principal, Dr. Sister Yesurani, all the faculty members of our college, and all the faculty members from other colleges, research scholars, and last but not the least, the students who are eagerly awaiting to listen to the lectures of this esteemed personality who we have amidst us courtesy of this webinar. At this pleasant moment, I appreciate English Department of JA College, which is celebrating its Golden Jubilee. English department has taken various initiatives in this direction with faculty and students to commemorate this divine moment through various seminars, competitions, webinars, and so on. The Literary Cornucopia is an endeavor of English department to strengthen the academic community. The theme of the webinar series is beautifully chosen by the organizing team. This literary cornucopia is organized as one of the salient features of Golden Jubilee celebration. Originally, cornucopia was a quartz horn filled with corn and fruit to symbolize plenty. Today, the cornucopia is used purely for Thanksgiving decorations. It continues to symbolize abundance, a bountiful harvest, and by extension, and appreciation for both of those things. Here, Cornucopia reflects both Thanksgiving and webinar series with variety of topics. I take this opportunity to congratulate and appreciate Dr. Ms. Patricia Albina Nirmalam, Head and Associate Professor of English, and Mrs. Angeline Sornam,
Sister, your audio is muted. Thank you, Sister.
Each topic for discussion and debate for each day webinar is chosen. Keep in mind the interest of youth. Once again, I congratulate all the professors of English department for their wholehearted and kind-hearted support and wholehearted cooperation and unstinted support. I sincerely believe that the lectures of these erudite, eminent, and sought-after speakers shall be highly informative and will leave a profound effect on you all. May the good Lord be with you and anoint you with the oil of wisdom and intelligence. Wishing you all the absolute best. May your life be radically rooted in life. May it be a path of light for many. May this English department grow and develop into a mighty tree to serve as an academic board of knowledge and wisdom. May all that you do be blessed by God. May God, in His kindness and goodness, be a great support to you today and every day. Wish you all the best.
Thank you, Sister, for your graceful felicitations filled with the blessings of the Lord Almighty. In our principal, Reverend Sister Dr. J. Sesarani, we have a leader who can translate vision into reality. Girded with integrity, insight, and inclusiveness, Sister has been instrumental in taking JSC to ever greater heights. I warmly welcome dear Sister to deliver her presidential address.
Am I audible, my dears?
Yes, Sister.
Yes, Sister, you're audible. Respected chief guest of the day, Dr. Samuel Rufus, Associate Professor of English, Madras Christian College, Chennai. Reverend Sister Dr. P.J. Queensley Jayanthi, Secretary of our College and Mother Superior of JSC College Community. All former Professor of the Department of English. Dr. Patricia Alfie Nirmala, Head of the Department of English. Mrs. Angeline Swarana, Convener of the Webinar Series. Mrs. Anamika, Organizing Secretary, other faculty members and student of the Department of English, distinguished alumni of the department, a very warm evening to you all. Golden Jubilee of our college has been celebrated in the month of December 2021 in a very grand manner.
Sister, you're muted now. Sister, your audio got muted.
Is it okay now? Is it
No, it's fine.
No, sorry. Inception of the college in 1971. Department of English has its own pride and honor since it started 50 years ago. At this outset, I wish all the faculty members and students of the Department of English a very happy Golden Jubilee. Congratulations, everyone, on 50 years of unforgettable moments. As the principal, I feel very proud of the achievements of the Department of English over the past 50 years. Starting from pre-university course, the department has now grown as a PG department and moving towards the status of a research center. Starting from Sister Canisius, Mrs. Premavalli, all faculty members have contributed a lot for the development of the college and the department in various capacities. Yes, Department of English has donated its faculty members to the college as the principal, vice principal, dean, college union vice president, NSS POs, and all important positions in the college. Dear former professors, you are the pillars of the department. Your hard work and great commitment has brought great success to the department as we see today. All your contributions are remembered with gratitude in the history of the college. What the department today is the fruit of your dedication and devotion to duty. All of you have shown your great concern towards the college by assisting in various administrative capacities. Thank you all. Following your footsteps, present professors are also doing their best in all their portfolio, making the department to shine. Thirst towards research is rising up in them. Dear faculty members, we expect your fullest cooperation for transforming our College of Higher Learning into Center of Excellence in future. Remember the noble service of your senior professors and take the department to greater heights. With regard to students, they also have jointly lifted the department in the ladder of success. Yes, many alumni of the Department of English are occupying prestigious positions in the society. At this juncture, I again congratulate all former professors, present professors, all alumni and present students of the Department of English on the special and auspicious occasion of the Golden Jubilee celebrations of the department. I also congratulate Dr. Petitia Nirmala, Alfie Nirmala, and other faculty members of the Department of English for the meticulous efforts in planning and conducting the inaugural parade on 13/1/2022 and this webinar series in a successful manner. I also congratulate all the resource persons of the webinar series, especially Dr. Samuel Rubis, for being a part of the celebrations. May every moment spent together bring a smile on your faces and strength for 50 more years together. May the department continue to flourish for all the times to come. Congratulations to all. Thank you. May God bless you, dears. Enjoy the day.
Thank you, sister.
Thank you, sister, for your captivating message. Sharing knowledge is most a fundamental act of friendship because it is a way you can give something without losing something, says Richard Stallman. I'm happy to welcome Mrs. Angelin Sarna, the convener of this webinar, to introduce the resource person.
Thank you, ma'am. It's an honor and sheer delight to have Dr. Samuel Rufus amidst us today. Dr. Rufus started his career as a lecturer with the American College Madurai and later joined Madras Christian College Chennai in 2003. He's the recipient of the University Gold Medal in MA English and the winner of the President Venkatraman Gold Medal for Academic Excellence from Bharathiya University. Some of his areas of interest are literary theory, postcolonial studies, bioregionalism, soft skills, and communication skills. He has served as a resource person in more than 100 seminars and conferences. He has authored 9 books, contributed chapters in 15 books, and has edited 12 books. His most popular book, Net Set Go, has helped countless aspirants successfully clear their eligibility exams. Dr. Rufus is the member of Board of Studies, Doctoral Committees, and Board of Examiners in various colleges and universities across Tamil Nadu and Kerala. He is the founding editor of Eclectic Representations, a peer review journal of the Department of English.
Participants
are requested to mute your devices.
Yes.
Thank you. Dr. Rufus is a lifelong learner who is pursuing his second PhD. He's a dedicated teacher who prepares for an average of 5 hours for a one-hour class. He's an obsessive reader who loves not Mandalas, but books more. He's an avid blogger who for more than 2 decades now has been offering the best of literary treats through his blog, Literary Musings. He's a generous spirit who with Tagore believes that knowledge should be free. He finds unalloyed pleasure in unstintingly sharing his resources through his YouTube channel and even through WhatsApp status messages. He's an erudite scholar who could speak for hours without a bit of notes in his hand. He's a critical thinker, translator, champion of digital detox, supporter of the marginalized, nature enthusiast, compulsive chronicler, practicing bioregionalist, and a true blue literary being. It has been our dream and desire to have Dr. Rufus speak in our college, and I'm glad that day has finally arrived. Amidst his immense academic and administrative commitments, he has agreed to be here with us today, and we are honored, sir. We are also very pleased that you've agreed to speak on a very pertinent but long neglected topic of literary gerontology. Warm welcome, dear sir, and over to you.
Thank you, ma'am, for those generous words. I don't think I deserve most of them. And thank you, Sister Principal, and thank you, the management. Thank you, Department of English, for having me here this evening. It's indeed a great pleasure to be with you. I'll straight away go to the topic at hand. I'll be talking today on literary gerontology, a new field, a budding field of research that could be very interesting, engaging, and rewarding at the same time. So some of the terms might be new to you, to researchers, especially if you have a pen and a notebook at hand. You could make notes of some of the terms, especially because this is a field that requires a lot of attention and has immense scope also. I'll just tune into the PowerPoint slides that I have. Just give me a minute. Yeah. So the term critical in gerontology, we all know the term critical is used in theory also, critical theory. So what do we mean by critical in critical theory or critical in critical gerontology? I'll be analyzing this term. Before that, I'll give you 3 interesting terms that are popular in critical theory. According to Louis Althusser, the guru of Michel Foucault, to an extent, he says, human subjectivity is constructed. Human subjectivity is constructed by ideology. Lacan says, Jacques Lacan says, human subjectivity is constructed by language. Michel Foucault says, human subjectivity, my subjectivity, your subjectivity is constructed by discourse. I repeat, Louis Althusser says, human subjectivity is constructed, he says it is constructed. Lacan says it is constructed. Foucault says it is constructed. So I am just emphasizing on the word constructed when it comes to a discourse, when it comes to language, when it comes to ideology. So who am I? I am a construct based on the ideology, in the culture, in the literature that I am a part of, you are a part of. So the word critical in critical gerontology, going by Louis Althusser's ideology or Lacan's language or Foucault's discourse, the word critical could mean questioning all those taken for granted assumptions that have constructed us. All those basic givens. This is a term that I love a lot because this is from Peter Barry's beginning theory that most of us are the basic givens of our existence, the normatives of our existence that are handed over to us faithfully from generation to generation. The first name in the application would be the name of the father, then the name of the mother. Have you seen any application form that has the name of the mother first? You won't find it. Basic givens of our existence. A family should have a head, and the head is normatively, the basic given is the dad, not the mom. The mom always has to consult with the dad. And even during weddings, we take the oath where it is said the husband has to love the wife, but the wife has to be obedient to the husband. Some of the normatives, some of the basic givens of our existence. Critical gerontology involves an active questioning or a continuous questioning or a persistent questioning of what these normatives, these basic givens of our existence, these taken for granted assumptions. Why? Because human subjectivity is constructed according to Althusser, is constructed according to Lacan, is constructed according to Michel Foucault. It is constructed. So, and what do we do there? The term there I love a lot, unsettle all these normative assumptions and unmask the ideologies that underlie our societies and ways of living. So that's why the word critical, unmasking, unsettling all the ideologies, the language frameworks, and the discursive apparatuses. That is the word critical in critical gerontology. Gerontology, study of aged and aging, right? Geriatrics is different from gerontology. We'll be having a look into that shortly. And today it will be just a bird's eye view, a cursory eye view, because of the shortness of time. I'll be as brief as possible. Maybe towards the end, we could have an interaction or a question answer session. Right, now coming to, I'll just turn on my, narrative gerontology. Narrative gerontology, the narrative is not interested in the story, but interested in how the story is said. Once there lived a king, once there lived a prince, have you ever seen these binaries being distorted or reset? Once there lived a queen, she had a king. How the story is said. A narrative is interested in the telling of the story, not the story. How the story is said in the order of time. Time order is very important in a narrative, or in other words, the architecture, the framework that makes up a story. So it scrutinizes the way in which a story is constructed. We are all storied beings. If I repeat again, Louis Althusser says we are constructed by ideology. Lacan says we are constructed by language. Foucault says we are constructed by discourse. We are also storied beings who are constructed by the stories that we grew up with. Maybe when we were children, mom put us on her shoulders like this when we were sleeping or when we were in bed, and you were here. Your sister was here on either side, and mom began to tell you a story. And when she stops midway, immediately you will ask, "Ma, continue." Mom would have slept by then. "Mom, continue. Tell me the story." "Okay, once there lived a chingam, chingamama, a lion. Then the lion was caught. In a huge net. By who? The hunters. Then. Now, narrative gerontology looks at the stories that construct us. And we grew up with those stories. That is why they say, you know, Freud also says, the first 7 years, Lacan also gives emphasis on the first 7 years, then our children should grow up with good, engaging, rewarding stories. But unfortunately, these days, the stories are lost. The reason they have what is called a cell phone with them, where they listen to whatever they want to. The art of storytelling, how they construct us, how they transform our sensibilities, how they help us see ways of seeing society. And that is why narrative gerontology looks at how stories construct us as human beings, how stories have constructed the old people or old age or the process of aging. Now, how theories of aging are socially constructed.
Don't think the slides are moving. God, do you need to change the slides?
I'm sorry. Is it moving now? No?
No.
I'm sorry. Thank you for telling me.
No, it's fine, sir. Thank you.
It's fine. Right. Okay. Now, yeah. So this is narrative. Now, this is narrative gerontology for you. And that is why when we have one gray hair on us, just one gray hair, we call it white hair. Actually, it's gray hair. One gray hair sports on us. The next moment, we become so sad. We become so dejected. We become so gloomy. They say, the moment you become 30, that is when the world turns upside down for some. No, not 30. Till then, we'll say, I'm 20s. The moment you know something dreaded word, 30. Same. One gray hair. Why is that? Narrative gerontology tells us this is because of the stories that have constructed us, that has told us that having a gray hair is a sign of aging, which has always been a pejorative and negative label in society. That's why Simone de Beauvoir, she calls it gerontophobia, fear of aging or fear of elderly also. Now, I'll give you a very humorous, at the same time insightful poem here. Are you able to see the poem now? Yehuda Halevi, a 12th century Spanish Jewish poet. Just four lines. See how his perspective, right? When a lone silver hair appeared on my head, I plucked it out with my hand and it said, "You've beaten me one-on-one, but what will you do with the army to come? You've beaten me one-on-one, but what will you do with the army to come?"
Sir.
Yes?
You're not able to see, sir.
I'm sorry. Thank you for that reminder. Now you are able to see it?
No, sir. Yes, sir, we are able to see it.
Okay, right. So, this poem highlights the importance given to this concept, gerontophobia. How we are afraid, especially in the Westocentric framework. I'm not trying to essentialize when I say this. This is Simone de Beauvoir who tells us that West in general, Western literature in particular, has always been afraid of the concept of aging. That is why, and the concept of death also. One reason why they don't use the word dead people. They use the word dear departed. They don't use the word they died or she died. They just say she passed away. The reason is they are not able to confront the term aging. It is a phobia for them, says Simone de Beauvoir, not only Simone de Beauvoir, Kathleen Woodward, a very famous Freudian scholar. She says the reason is because Kathleen Woodward, we'll come to her. Kathleen Woodward says, this is because of Freud, Sigmund Freud, who had an aversion to the process of aging itself, right? And literary gerontology. Literary gerontology. First, we discussed critical gerontology, narrative gerontology, now literary gerontology, which we'll be discussing in a bit more elaborate detail in the next few minutes. So this looks at ways in which stories of age and aging have been examined in literature. Literary scholars, we all know, were the pioneering humanists. Please remember, English literature came to us only because of the humanists. And the humanists, not necessarily from England, the humanists had a great love of humanity. Please don't compare the humanists with the religious people, because the religious people had a different law code, moral code. The humanists had a different code. For the humanists, the code was a social code, a moral code based on the dictates of a society. But for the religious people, the code was always the scriptures that governed society. So the humanists were more broad-minded. It was the first English humanist, Thomas More and others, Erasmus. They were all humanists to begin with. A love of humanity. They went abroad, right, to all those centers of learning in Padua, in Greece, in Italy. They went there, learned and came back, and then propagated in England this literary, fiery, passionate literary spirit. So the educationists, they were all humanists. So here also you find, right, the literary scholars were the pioneering humanists who explored the concept of aging through time. The time is very important when it comes to the concept of aging. Sartre says, no? Jean-Paul Sartre, he says, one does not possess one's past as one possesses a thing. It's not like you possess a fluorescent pen, a marker pen, a highlighter pen. It's not like you possess, it's not, the past is not possessed like you possess a thing. But you can bring it back from memory. That's why Aristotle says, the old live by memory than by hope. The old live by memory. I hope that slide has turned now. I've come to the next one. Here, this is Mauriac, Francois Charles Mauriac, a French novelist. A beautiful line that I loved from this memoir. He wrote 10 years before his death. He says, when I was a little boy, I looked back, you know, longingly into the world when I was a little boy. And he says, you know, this was when he was old, right? He writes in his memoir. I looked back longingly at the time when I was a little boy, at the time when I stole into the bosom of my mother, cuddled under her, you know, cuddled under her like this, under her warm embrace. And I imagine saying, Mama or Amma. I imagine myself cuddling up under the warm embrace of my Amma or Mama and saying, you know, that coziness, that comfort, looking back, memories or vestiges of the past that you carry. You can't possess it, but it can come to you through those memories, involuntary memories that give you those nostalgic reveries, he says. Recovery of time past. Time past, you recover it through those memories. Sometimes it is flashbulb memories. Sometimes it is involuntary memory. For Marcel Proust, the great novelist, dunking those Madeleine is a piece of a cake into his tea, made him recollect a childhood event. When for the first time he dunked his madeleine in his tea. So he recollects that event when he dunked his madeleine in his tea and when the madeleine touched his upper palate. That was the moment that changed his life forever, he says. Looks back into the past, a reverie, a kind of a nostalgic reminiscence. Now he says, when this madeleine touched the upper lip, or the upper palate, my world changed. It gave me a different dimension to my existence. 4,215 pages, 7 volumes, a huge novel that he wrote after that. Just this experience of the madeleine dunking it in his cup of tea. Flashbulb memories, we call it. Involuntary memories, we call it. So the old, I repeat, to Aristotle, the old live by memory than by hope. Now, I have come to the next slide. I hope it has changed here. A new aesthetic. This is
so what we are still seeing the literary gerontology slide.
Oh, good, 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 good that you told me, ma'am. Yeah. A new aesthetic. Just a minute. Yeah. Is it visible now?
Yes, sir.
Yes, thank you. Yeah. So, what does literary gerontology aim to do? It aims to provide a new aesthetic. Why a new aesthetic? Why the new learning in England in the Renaissance? Just before the Renaissance, you had a new learning. Why? Because the old learning was stereotyped, was cliched, was filled with stigmas, was filled with dogmas. So a new learning happened. Here, a new aesthetic, because the old aesthetic had a lot of silences, 3 S's that I always use, silences, stereotypes, and stigmas. Not only silences, stereotypes, and stigmas, but also misrepresentations, misconceptions, and pejorative labeling of the elderly, of the concept of aging. So what is needed is a new aesthetic. Literary gerontology strives to provide a new aesthetic by how? By defining, classifying, analyzing, interpreting, and evaluating representations of aging and creativity through those close readings of literary texts. And finally, it offers new alternatives to society's narrow, limiting, constraining stereotypes of the elderly. That's what it does, right? A new aesthetic. Just, I'm turning it to the next one. Yeah, maybe there is a problem in changing part. That's why. How old is old? Postmodernists would have us believe that the terms, you know, any term is relative. There are no absolute truths. So in postmodernism, how old is old? When children, you ask children, anyone who is an adult is old. Don't associate with that boy. He's an old man. He'll be just 16 years old. But for the child, he or she is old. So don't associate with anyone above 30. They're old. The first time you hear the word auntie pronounced on you, the verdict is passed. The first time when someone calls you an uncle, the verdict is passed. Your life is fixed from then on. That means your youthfulness is slowly slipping you. No one taught this girl to call you an auntie. No one taught this boy to call him an uncle. But spontaneously it comes. So how old is old? Kathleen Woodward says, you know, she uses the example of Sigmund Freud's mother, Amelia Freud. She was 95 years when she was asked this question. Who do you think is old? You know what Amelia Freud said? Anyone who is 100 years old is old. Now she was 95. She died at 95. Anyone who is 100 years old is old. So how old is old? Well, structuralist theories are liberative because the term old is absolutely relative. That gives us a lot of scope for expanding more on this topic of how old is old. Right, I'm going on to the next slide. Yeah. Now, middle age and old age in the popular imagination. First, we'll discuss middle age, and then we'll move on to the concept of old age quickly as possible. There has always been a bad press for middle age. Bad press means bad stereotypes or negative stereotypes about the middle age. It is also called the midlife crisis by Elliot Jacques. You know, midlife crisis. They say, no, what is middle age? When age starts showing around your middle, for men, they say, you know, the paunch comes up. So middle age is when your age starts to show around the middle. So the bad press for middle age, why was that? Was it always like this in the past? How does literature reflect this occurrence of the middle age? Does it celebrate or venerate, or does it demote middle age? We'll find just one or two examples quickly after highlighting on the term midlife crisis by the famous Canadian psychoanalyst. He was the one who came up with this term midlife crisis for men, and menopause for women, we call it, right? That term was not coined by Elliot Jacques, but midlife crisis was coined by Elliot Jacques. Then the term middlescence was coined by Barbara Waxman, a very famous gerontologist. And in her wonderful book, From the Hearth to the Open Road, 1990, middlescence, what's middlescence? Like adolescence, middlescence, the time when you are in middle age. I'm just moving on to the next one quickly. This is Cicero, who gives us a defense. The first defense of old age comes long back. Down the ages, you find Cicero gives a defense of old age. The reason is old age then was looked down upon. So he had to give four defenses of, old age, right? Not middle age. Quickly going on to the next one Hippocrates. He was we can't use superlatives when it comes to post-structuralism or post-modern theories also. We never use superlatives. He was the first, we can't necessarily say. Maybe one of the earliest, we could say. That's why I very carefully worded it. One of the earliest to compare the stages of human life to nature's four seasons, we know spring, summer, autumn, and winter. Winter, old age. He was one of the first to compare winter with old age, right? And then Aristotle, he has written a lot of treatises, poetics, politics, physics, right? In one of his treatises on old age, he says, growing old is a very bad phase during one's life because a person, when he is young or she is young, they have a lot of heat or energy in them. But as they grow old, they lose this heat, he says. Right? So Galen, another great physician, in his gerocomia, see the term gerocomia, it was used very long back, defined old age as something lying between illness and health, another negative term for old age. So old age, like middle age, has always had a bad press in the past, and we'll see how the term evolves over the course of centuries very quickly. Professor Roger Bacon, he was the one who invented the magnifying glass. I hope this slide is visible. Professor Roger Bacon, 13th century. He also wrote about a treatise on the cure of old age and preservation of youth. He looked upon old age as a disease. See, again, the normative for old age, as in all the negative terms here you find, you know, winter, loss of heat, something between illness and health, and old age as a disease. So that's why, you know, he wrote a treatise on the hygiene of old age. Then there is an Italian professor by name Zerbi, gerontocomia, on the care of the aged. One of the first printed treatises on geriatrics. Geriatrics, right? We all know is the medical, not the literal, right? The medical study of the elderly, the old, right? Quickly. This is a representation. I had a lot of paintings, but because of lack of time, I had to cut short some 5 or 6 of them. Maybe later on, we can have a discussion. This is credits to Alamy.
This session is till 8:30. You can take till 8:15 also. Then we can have another 15. So you have one more hour.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for that. Yes, that'll be nice. Lucas Cranach the Elder. Just observe this painting. This painting, it's called the Fountain of Youth, right? And you find from the left, there are people being driven in chariots, old people being driven in chariots. They're all so crazy about this, you know, fountain of youth. You know, there were even people who were so obsessed with this concept of fountain of youth that they went ahead and they founded Florida and a few other states, we are told. Coming back, this fountain of youth was supposed to be a pool into which when you get in naked without clothes and you swim in it, you come out to the right side as a person filled with the vitality of youth. And you'll have, you know, you'll have a beautiful dinner table, a dining table where you can have your food along with everyone else. And you can dance with the people there and see the way the old there. If you can have a close look at their eyes, they are so curious, right? The old, the elderly are brought in cauldrons like chariots. And then they come there, they enter the pool, and then they have a swim for hours together. See, the way they enjoy the swim, that's because it is called the Fountain of Youth. Just imagine today you find a Fountain of Youth. How many of you would be loving or excited to go and jump into the Fountain of Youth and come out as young and vibrant? So these are representations, portrayals, Michelangelo, or Da Vinci especially, right? His portrayal of the aged has not been very positive, right? A bit cold. He himself drew his own self-portrait when he was a bit aged, and he was a bit critical. So look at the Renaissance stereotypes of the elderly. This is Cranach the Elder's, and this is Da Vinci's The Vitruvian Man. I hope it is visible here. Just a moment. Yeah. This is, you know, any painting for that matter should have a symmetry to it, a proportion to it. And Da Vinci, the typical Renaissance painter that he was, we all know the strenuous extent to which he went to make his paintings symmetrical in proportion. Any painting, when you observe it, you will observe it only for its proportion. Artists, especially oil on canvas, you'll find this promotion, this proportion is very meticulously followed. So, you know, we all know that the proportions that we have, the thumb to the count of the nose, or this side to the count of, you know, we use a lot of proportions when we look at or appreciate a picture. Da Vinci, they say, he was supposed to be the father of modern anatomy because he was one of the first to ever dissect human beings. You know why he dissected human beings? He himself says, not human beings in the sense, dead bodies, cadavers. He admits, I have dissected around 30 cadavers. Why? Because he wanted to see proportion, symmetry, how the intestines function. Where do they begin? Where do they end? Where do the lungs come? Where do the kidneys come? Now, to study the proportion, a painter had done that. And this Vitruvian man is an example of the symmetry. And here you find, if you are very carefully observe it, it is a middle-aged man. The middle-aged man, according to Da Vinci, not the old, the middle-aged man, is the ideal example of, or the perfect example of, the Renaissance human being, a celebration of middle age, not old age. The Vitruvian man, because they say, many say, when he was middle-aged when he drew this portrait. And this is celebrated the world over for any many reasons. Even today, painters all the world over look up to this example of the Vitruvian man by Da Vinci for any many reasons. Now, this middle age that you find celebrated in Da Vinci, the same Renaissance period, you have Shakespeare in his Hamlet giving us a beautiful line. What a piece of work is man. How noble in reason. How infinite in variety. How noble in reason, in science and, you know, in form and moving, how like an angel. We find that. The same Shakespeare who says, what a piece of work is man. He wrote it again in his middle age, Hamlet. In King Lear, you find the same Shakespeare gives us a hero, an old man, and a line that comes that, is this all, you know, I'll give you those lines, is this all a man could possibly be, right? Is man no more than this? The same Shakespeare who celebrated humans, or, you know, I'm not trying to sound sexist when I say this, I'm just echoing the language of Shakespeare. What a piece of work is man, here he says in King Lear, during his old age, King Lear says this lines, is man no more than this? Right. So in 17th century, again, you know, coming down quickly, you have great works on old age. The a famous Italian, Morgagni's book on anatomy. First time it had a section on old age. I hope it's visible. Yeah. It had a section devoted to old age, the study of old age. We call it gerontology. The medical part, it is geriatrics, right? And Seiler's book on the anatomy of the aged. Then geriatrics as a field of study came up only after the 1850s. Now, this is very interesting, right? The Salpêtrière in Paris, supposed to be the largest. It's like Jipmer in Pondicherry, if you've been there. It is a kind of a teaching hospital where you find medicos or interns or final year students trying to learn about the nuances of medicine or care and treatment of especially the disabled, the learning disabled, the mentally ill, the poor, and the aged or the old. And this is a very interesting place, a hospital, teaching, learning hospital, supposed to be the largest in Europe. You can key in later to find out something about the Salpêtrière, because this was the place that also launched or inspired Sigmund Freud. this is Schacht, right? Jean-Martin Schacht. He was a professor, a medical practitioner, also a professor, who gave a lot of lectures on elderly, on the care of the elderly, to students who came there from all across the world. Just because he was there, they used to come from all parts of the world, from all parts of Europe, all corners of the world, to just listen to him with a notebook in their hand. So like just last week, I was watching Emily Dickinson. Dickinson, that famous TV series that came up now, just recently it ended, where you find Dickinson, the protagonist there. She is forbidden to enter male territory where there is a lecture going on volcanoes, but she is excited because her father is part of the university. She comes to know that there is a lecture happening. She puts on the cloak of a man and she rushes to the lecture, and with notes in hand, she observes whatever the professor is saying. Like that, and the professor is standing there at the podium, and he is explaining on the concept of volcanoes, because volcanoes always connect with Dickinson's poetry. We know that. So like that, here you find Professor Schacht is explaining to his students on the care of the old, the mentally ill, the poor. And Sigmund Freud happens to visit the center after having learned of Schacht. Please remember, Sigmund Freud also christened his eldest boy the same name as Jean-Martin Schacht. The reason is he became a great fan of Schacht. So he christened his eldest boy, because he saw potentialities of a great a neuropsychiatrist in his son. So he christened him, Schacht. So Schacht was one of the pioneering doctors who celebrated or spoke on the problems of old age. See, till then, old age was considered a disease, but for the first time, here he says, no, it's not like that. Old age is a phase in our lives. It's a phase in one's life, in time. The concept of time is very important, because Eliot, I just look back to Eliot in his four quartets, such a meaningful piece of poetry, right? Four quartets, time present and time past. The past has lengthened like a shadow, and the future is very less. That's why Sartre says, you can't possess the past. It has lengthened. Now I can look back, have flashback, flashbulb memories, have a flashback, look at some things. You just show an old person something that they could connect with, their eyes will widen. Their face will, exhibit a smile. Just something that they could recollect, that they could connect with, flashbulb memories, or just images of the past, photographs. Susan Sontag, last week she celebrated a birthday. She talks about the power of a photograph to resurrect the past, to bring to attention the past. So here again, till then, the past was a lengthening shadow, the winter, ill health. But for the first time, there was a neuropsychiatrist who delved into old age with such a positive bent of mind. Sigmund Freud was inspired by Schacht. He went and learned about the elderly, about neuropsychiatry. And when he wrote his 1895, Studies in Hysteria, he was heavily influenced by Schacht. Right? So the Salpêtrière in Paris was one of the pioneering centers, one of the largest in Europe, that discussed the problems of the aged. Just give me a minute. Yeah. Yeah, quickly going into the 19th century in literature. Perspectives on aging that you find in the 19th century. In the past, you had a negative press for the middle age and for old age as well. But there were some redeeming hearts redeeming souls who try to give us a positive bent of mind, including Shaket. In the 19th century, you have some such redeeming features or perspectives on aging. Jacob Grimm, right, his treatises or his short stories also, right, you find these redemptive features on the aged. Victor Hugo. I'm just giving you examples of these writers because we won't have much time to. Charles Dickens, we all know. Little Nell had a grandfather, right, the bond that they shared. Little Nell, right, Charles Dickens, Balzac, Emile Zola, then Thomas Mann. Some examples in the 19th century that have some redemptive features on the elderly. Please remember, all the narratives in narrative gerontology, when we study the narratives that have been handed down to us over the ages, how they construct the elderly. This is what literary gerontology is all about. Perspectives on the aged and elderly in literature. Right. I hope. Leon Asher is a very sentimental event that happened. An Austrian-American doctor. He was the one who coined the term or gave us the term geriatrics. He's an Austrian-American doctor born in Vienna. Vienna is supposed to be the center, the hub of elders. And a place in the world, one of the very interesting places in the world where the elderly are living a very happy life, it seems. Like Denmark, they say, no? One of the happiest countries in the world, they say. Tops the index of one of the happiest countries in the world, right? Denmark, like that. Vienna was supposed to be a center in the world where the aged, especially, you know, the old, the elderly, were supposed to live happy lives. When doctors, psychiatrists visited the center, you know, in Vienna, where, you know, old people get together, meet, exchange pleasantries, they dance, they revel, they make merry, just like the young people do. They, you know, Fra Lippo, from Lippi, you find in Robert Browning, paints the town red. Similarly, you know, they paint the town red. Now someone asked the doctors in Vienna, where Nasher was born, right, Austria, Vienna, why are the elderly here so happy? Why are the elderly here without an iota of sadness or grief on them? Why are they so exuberant, filled with the joie, the joy of life? And then the doctor told them, it seems, you know, the doctor gave the reply. The thing we do is very simple. Like how a pediatrician takes care of a child with love, care, nurture, and warmth, the same way we take care of our elders with love, with care, nurture, and warmth. Even as I'm talking to you, you know, this evening, I'll just make you recollect as literary beings, when was the last time you spoke, as research scholars, many of you, when was the last time you spoke to your mother just to inquire about her health? When was the last time you spoke to your dad, not asking for money? Dad, give me this, give me that. Dad, how's your health? How are you doing? How are you feeling? When was the last time we inquired about them? Not pouring out our grievances to them. The care to a child, see the comparison, no? A child is given the warmth, the care, the love, and the affection. The child needs attention. A child is not a jandu, it's not an object. He or she is endowed with the richness of life. The more care, the more happiness. The same, he said. Vienna is a center where the old people thrive with the joy of life, it seems. So Leon Asher was born in Austria and Vienna, and then he went on to America. One particular incident there touched him a lot, and that was, you know, as a young practicing medico, an intern, they were all going around to the professor, the professor, and the professor was asking one of the patients, an old woman, about her problems. The old woman, she told the professor about her various complaints that she was suffering from. Then The professor replied, "The only disease for you, my old lady, is the disease of your age, nothing else," he said. Now, Nasher, a very curious, intrigued young scholar, like Derrida in 1966, a very young, vibrant scholar, Nasher was very curious. He then asked his professor, "What can be done about it? Could anything be done about it?" When an old lady comes and complains about the various ailments and problems that she was suffering from, the professor just replies, "No, we can't do anything about it. No solutions. It's just your old, great age, lady. We don't have solutions. What can be done about it?" This set the young Nasher troubled in his mind and his conscience. Nothing. Nothing. Absolutely nothing. He was struck by the reply that he went home, pondered on this word, what can be done about such old women, their complaints? Who is going to be there to listen to the complaints, their problems? And that is when he decided to devote himself to the study of the problem or the process of aging, right? And that's when, in the year 1909, he coined the term geriatrics, right? So, yeah. But, you know, in the 1930s, 40s, although the first international conference on aging was held in 1938, a whole lot of things happened. But unfortunately, the gerontological society could not be established because of the world wars that happened. So, only 1945, the first gerontological society happened, was founded in the US in 1945. Please remember, there is a difference between geriatrics and gerontology. Geriatrics has a medical slant to it, a medical study. But gerontology is the study of aging and the elderly, not necessarily about the medical part, right? It's not pathological in its approach. So the first gerontological society in the US happened in the year 1945. And quickly, yeah. Two interesting writers or scholars who have said extensively about this gerontophobia of Western culture. One is Kathleen Woodward. We discussed her earlier also. Aging and its Discontents, 1991. If this title of the book strikes a chord in you, I hope it strikes a chord in you. 1939, please check out the year. Sigmund Freud, sorry, 1929. Yeah, 1930 it was into English. 1929, Sigmund Freud comes up with a Civilization and its Discontents. Civilization and its Discontents. But Freud was averse to the concept of aging. We discussed this earlier. So she deliberately takes a pun on the title, and she came up with a book in the year 1991, which says aging and its discontents, a pun on the title of Sigmund Freud. In Sigmund Freud's book, he talks about how civilization represses an individual's freedom. Civilization and its discontents. Civilization, the concept of civilization, represses you, represses me, what Louis Althusser would later call repressive state apparatus or ideological state apparatus, the ideology, language, discourse that suppresses or represses the individual freedom to do what I want to do. Civilization and its discontents. Here you find Kathleen Woodward giving us a very interesting work titled Aging and Its Discontents, where she talks about this concept of gerontophobia that has pervaded or invaded Western fabric, Western culture. Most of literature in the West, according to Kathleen Woodward. Again, right, these are the findings of two great scholars. One is Simone de Beauvoir, 1970. You should please read The Coming of Age by Simone de Beauvoir, a friend of Sartre, an amazing scholar, right? If at all I'm blessed with the chance to meet one person from the past, it would be Simone de Beauvoir, right? What are my 545 odd pages of On the Aged, which is written on, you know, this wonderful treatise on aging and the process of aging, where after doing an extensive survey over down the ages, over the centuries, she comes up with the findings. She says, the West has always been allergic to the process or the concept of aging. Gerontophobia. Now you find, I'm just quoting Simone de Beauvoir here, Kathleen Woodward also, you know, the second part will be mentioning her. Simone de Beauvoir says, society looks upon old age as a shameful secret. I repeat, society looks upon old age as a shameful secret that is highly unbecoming to even make mention. It is not only a secret, it is a shameful secret that should not be out there in the open. You can't discuss. This is gerontophobia, she calls it. Not the, you know, not the opposite, gerontomania, love. No, it is a extreme of fear. Fear is there, but extreme of fear is phobia. And that's why she says, this is her phrase, we need to break this conspiracy of silence. And the concept of calling it a forbidden subject. The conspiracy of silence surrounding, you know, she calls it the forbidden subject. It cannot, that has to be hushed. You can't, you know, we can find instances, right, in the past also, Wordsworth or Keats or the romantic poets, how they discuss, like trailing clouds of glory, do we come from heaven, which is our home, the young boy, right? And in seven stages, maybe we can discuss that if we have the time. By the melancholy Jacques, you know, the infant, the student, the young man, then the middle age, then comes to, you know, old age, and finally death, dotage and death. There you find an extolling or a celebration of youthfulness. Shall I compare thee to a summer's day? Why doesn't he say, shall I compare thee to a winter's day? Shall I compare thee to a summer's day? You are the spring of my life, not the winter of my life. In the spring of youth, old age has its own honor and its toil. All these negative associations with elders and elderly that you find in most, not all. There are redeeming features about Western culture and Western literature also that have been discussed. But I'm just talking about these two because they also offer us redemptive parallels from other cultures. And Kathleen Woodward's essay, The Mirror Stage of Old Age, is from her book titled Aging and Its Discontents. It is from chapter 3. It's a very simple chapter. You can read it. The Mirror Stage of Old Age. Remember The Mirror Stage by Lacan? Lacan talks about how the child, it becomes he or she, gets an identity the moment she or he could feel herself in the mirror, see herself in the mirror. Till then, she feels she and everything else is one. It, a bundle of, that's it, a mass. But the moment the child looks at herself in the mirror for the first time in her life, sometimes as kids, we would have done that. Almost everyone does that, says Lacan. The first time when we stand in front of a mirror, identify ourselves with the mirror, mirror image, raise our hand, there also the hand is raised. Scratch our head, there also the head is scratched. Oh, this is weird. I thought I was a part of everything else. I thought I was part of Amma. I thought I was a part of Appa. I thought I was part of my siblings. No. I have an individuality. I have an identity. I am an object. When the first time the child recognizes herself or himself on the mirror. But that is a time in childhood, the mirror stage, is a time of identification that borders on joyfulness, says Lacan. That Eureka moment, no? That joy. But here, in the mirror stage of old age, the old man or the old woman is afraid to see herself or himself in the mirror because the experience that it would evoke would be something bordering on uncanny. No, 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 I don't want to see myself in the mirror. Please, please, please. Don't show me a mirror. I hate to see myself in the mirror now. All these wrinkles. You mean I have to, you know, once so I was asked to give some good gifts to an old couple who lived just a couple of streets away, a doctor, a retired doctor. Very old couple, a wonderful couple. So I went to his house with the goodies. Just, I should have, you know, called him up and gone there, but spontaneously I was asked to go, so I went there. The doctor uncle was shocked. Oh, Rufus, you should have told me that you are coming. And, you know, with a sense of humor, he always says, I would have done some makeup. I would have done some powdering. I would have done some makeup. You should have told me that you are coming. A real incident that happened. You know? So I don't want to see myself in the mirror. Structures. The uncanny, she uses the word again from Lacan. Because the mirror stage of old age is something that you don't want to associate yourself with. The uncanny. Again, gerontophobia of Western culture says, Kathleen Woodward, this is not Rufus saying this, this is Kathleen Woodward saying it, and I don't want to essentialize, but just give you from these two great minds. Right? And just give you one insightful example from one of my favorite poets, Sylvia Plath. This is again mirror, which we have prescribed also for us. Sylvia Plath's mirror. It tells you about how society views you. Look at that. I am silver and exact. What is silver and exact? The mirror. As a little girl, she grew up in her own boudoir, her own space. Boudoir, a woman's room. She grew up. There was a mirror that was hanging on the wall. Just imagine a mirror hanging at the back here. 24/7, it's there. Now the mirror speaks. What does the mirror say? I am silver and exact. I have no preconceptions. Just because you are a girl, I won't show you as pretty or beautiful. Just because you are a boy, I won't. Or just because you're an old person, no, I have no preconceptions. Whatever I see, I swallow immediately. Just as it is, unmisted by love or dislike. No bias, no prejudice. Whatever I see, I swallow, I reflect. I'm not cruel. Don't call me cruel. I'm a mirror. I'm truthful. The first line, she says, no, I'm silver and exact. The eye of a little god, four-cornered. Most of the time, I meditate on the opposite wall. Sometimes when someone comes, they look at themselves and they leave. Sylvia Plath alone has possession of the mirror. So she comes, she looks at herself in the mirror, and then she leaves. Now, Sylvia Plath ages over time. As a young girl, now she's grown up into an adult, and later as an old woman. See how the mirror shows her here. Now I am a lake. A woman bends over me, searching for my reaches, for what she really is. Then she turns to those liars. She doesn't trust me because I'm so exact. As she grows older, she doesn't trust me. In camera, cell phones, no, we have some examples like that, right? What's that? We have filters. Filters for showing our own power better face to someone else. Filters make us happy. No, all those wrinkles, all those pimples, they are all deleted. No, 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 no. A bit fair shade or whatever, a glowing or filters give us a sense of liberation sometimes. So she doesn't turn to the mirror now. She turns to those liars, those filters, the candles or the moon. She reflects in a lake because she'll be, at least in the lake, the reflection of the moon, she'll be found pretty. I see her back and reflect it faithfully. She rewards me with tears and an agitation of hands. Now she's so timid, now she's so afraid, anxiety. I'm important to her, yes. I'm very important to her. That's why she comes and sees herself in this mirror. She comes and goes. Each morning, it is her face that replaces the darkness. In me, she has drowned a young girl. And in me, an old woman rises. Look at the comparison. Day after day, like a terrible fish. In Kafka's Metamorphosis, you'll find one morning, I found myself transformed into a gigantic insect, or in the original, it is monstrous vermin, monstrous vermin. The transformation. Here, one morning, see the last but third line, each morning, in the last line, a terrible fish, uncanny. Now I want you to give me one word, an open challenge to anyone. Maybe I can also award you a prize. What do you think is this mirror? What, in your opinion, is this mirror? Right, we discussed Sylvia Plath's mirror here. And I'm sorry, yeah. What do you think could be this mirror that Sylvia Plath is talking to us on? Maybe you can think about it, stop. Think, reflect, something that we tell our students, no? Especially researchers, you will get answers. So yeah, I'll give you an answer because of time.
There are a few answers there in the chat box. Sir.
Yes, yes, please. Yeah, can you? Yeah.
A critique, self, society, a perception, eyes, self-reflection, subconscious, her love, construct, lover, self-image of ourselves. So these are them.
Good, very good. I'm so happy with all the answers. All the answers are absolutely right. Absolutely right. Especially the ones on, you know, self-image or society. I really love that answer. Society. The mirror there is society. The mirror there is the human subjectivity that is constructed by society. Every time I go to society to check myself, I'm important to her society. Sigmund Freud talks about the reality principle. Then the last one is the society principle. How society can, civilization and its discontents. How society constrains me. How I am objectified by society. These are the inadequacies, the misrepresentations that happen in society about the elderly, that Kathleen Woodward talks to us in this wonderful essay as part of the book, Aging and Its Discontents. Quickly. Yeah. Now we have David Urban. David Urban, he specializes in indigenous literatures and non-Western literatures and cinemas. These are some examples that we can celebrate, rather, from David Urban. He has done an extensive research on indigenous literatures, where he, in this particular essay, you know, the role of the elderly in Native American literature. This is an essay, right? A part of a wonderful book. In this particular essay that he wrote, David Urban, he quotes a very interesting Native American writer, Leslie Marmon Silko, and he tries to analyze the text there. Please remember, narratives condition you and me. We are storied beings. Derrida would call us textual beings. Nietzsche would call us superior beings. Charles Darwin would call us accidental beings. But narrative would tell us we are the products of the stories that we grew up with. One reason why we re-emphasize again and again on the art of storytelling, which is waning. Not waxing, it's waning now. When was the last time we told stories to our children, to our kids? When was the last time our children listened to the stories coming out of them, and positive stories? Why should Raju always kill a tiger? In active voice and passive voice and sentences, no? in schools, in grammar classes, we say, Raju killed the tiger. Change the voice. Raju killed a snake. Why should the narrative always be negative? Why can't it be inclusive? The witch is always portrayed as an old woman, the old witch, the wizard, or, you know, one who does all kinds of negative things, always portrayed as stereotyped stories that we grew up with. Why should Raju always kill a snake? Raju loved the snake. Raju loved the tiger, changed the voice. And this is where narrative gerontology helps. The stories that we breathe into the hearts and the minds of our children are very important. About the elders, David Urban says, you find such prototypes or paradigms of such stories in Native American literatures, in indigenous literatures, he says. And he gives us some examples. I'm just quoting a few instances from particular examples that he gives us. The last three lines alone, I'll read it for you. Elders are valued in these texts by a Native American author, says David Urban, in a study of indigenous literatures. And by analyzing these texts, I hope to discover not simply moments within the consciousness of these works, but also an attitude towards elders typical of Native American cultures. Not a gerontophobic attitude that you find in some other cultures, but an attitude that borders on respect. In Chinua Achebe's Things Fall Apart, I still remember because I have taught it to my kids here, age is respected. Right? A line you'll find, I quoted it also here. Hope it is visible. So characters achieve a resolution of this conflict through the wise guidance of the elder. There is a conflict. We always are taught in our schools and especially literature classes. A novel, a play, or a short story will always have a conflict. Only when there is a conflict, there can be a solution to that conflict. So a conflict, any story will build up towards what is called, any movie will build up towards a conflict. Like we say, no, if we are storied beings, and in stories and novels you find conflicts. If we are storied beings, we also will have conflict. See the comparison, no? The conflict, the crisis, and then you have how it is resolved. There will be a conflict. Definitely there will be a conflict in a short story. You find the four stages of a short story, no? Premise, the development, conflict, then conclusion, or denouement, climax. Similarly, he says, the conflict is resolved in any conflict, in a novel, or a short story, or a play. How is the conflict resolved? Through the wise guidance of the elders of the tribes. See how the narrative changes the attitude, the perspective, the ways of seeing, how the elders are constructed in society. Let me be very honest. Let us be very honest to ourselves as literary souls. Let us be very honest. Let's ask ourselves, when was the last time we had a literature or a text that celebrates the elderly prescribed in our syllabus? We have a paper, right, as syllabus revision committee convener. We made sure we included a paper where we have a word called geriatric trauma. Trauma connected with the elderly. We have a whole lot of texts that celebrate, venerate, and that also dig into the problems that are faced by the elderly. When was the last time we read a text that venerated the elderly? When was the last time we read a poem and celebrated a poem? When was the last time we wrote a poem for Amamma? Have you ever written a poem for Grandma? We write poems for our lady love, Anbe. We write poems for everyone. Our friends, when was the last time we wrote poems? Or when was the last time we had a poem prescribed that venerated or celebrated the wisdom of the elderly? Let's be honest with ourselves. In this webinar series, literary gerontology, Let this be a transformative exercise, a therapeutic exercise, where we look upon our elders from a different perspective, ways of seeing, that Peter Barry would call it. So here, the tribe always has a great veneration for the past, not only for authority and for respect. And this comes, the source for this reverence for the past is the respect for elders. Right? And that is where everything falls in line for them, says David Urban. So this is from Things Fall Apart. Age was respected among his people, but achievement was revered. I love this line because the more you grow old, the more you are respected and revered. Yeah. There are three types of elders there in indigenous societies that David Urban talks about. One is see, and these elders are specialists. When you call a person a community elder, they are specialists in everything connected with community. Like you have deans in your university, deans specializing in deans of research, dean of student affairs, dean of women's students, or a person who specializes in our parlance, a person who specializes in Victorian literature, a person who specializes in bioregional literature, a person who specializes in eco-literature. Like that, in indigenous societies, they had elders who were specialists. They divided them into three. One is community elders, one is ceremonial elders, the next one is earth elders. You know, some of these, just last month, December, the second week, we had a death in a village, so down south, so we had to go there. We had food there, and finally I forgot to, in the plantain leaf, after the ceremony is over, they'll give us all food, right, in that custom in that village. So they gave us food in the plantain leaf, and then I forgot. As the norm is, we always fold the leaf towards our side, for the uravu, for the relation to prosper. In that particular manner, I folded it. Then immediately an old man from there, he ran up to me and said, no, for a death, you should fold it the other way. Right? There are elders who teach us some such ceremonies, rituals. There are elders, specialists in community, who tell us everything about how it has to be structured. Indigenous societies, it is not about the individual, but the community that is celebrated and venerated above the individual. One reason why things fell apart in Chinuwachibi is because the individual one-upmanship came up over the community. So here, ceremonial elders and earth elders, we are told that even as little children, I love quoting Krishnamurti here, because Krishnamurti is one of the very few academicians who taught us this. When you teach your kids stories that connect with Mother Earth, the child will grow up a very inclusive child, he said. In his Rishivari schools, he used to take the kids and make them see how a flower is blooming, how many days it takes for a flower to bloom, how many days it takes for sapling to come up. And he used to make the sit around him. I've told this already. Sit around him. Little kids. And he used to just pluck one leaf from the sapling. And when he plucks the leaf, he will make them empathize with the leaf and with the plant. And he'll tell them, see how much it will pain for this sapling when one leaf is plucked out. So the children are taught to empathize to such an extent, by the end of his demonstration, there are tears in the eyes of the kids. That is the last time they will ever see a leaf plucked out of a tree or a sapling. From then on, an inclusivity that connects with Mother Earth is born. In Esther and Kirei, you find this beautiful analogy where the river is a brother, the sea is a sister, the sea is a mother, the mountains are my brothers. See the connect. This is what we call earth elders. The elders there, immediately, the child, after a particular age, maybe 5 or 6, they are given as apprentice to these elders, where the elders teach them earth wisdom. We have Earth University, by Vandana Shiva. Like that, earth wisdom is taught in the minds and the hearts of the little kids. When do you have to sow? When do you have to reap? When do you have to do this? When do you have to harvest? When do you have to, plant everything? How to feed the cows? How to milk the cows? How to cultivate the land? Everything. This knowledge, not the men, not the women, it's the elderly who teach them, earth elders, right? And this concept is part of the narrative framework. So all Native American literatures or indigenous literatures you'll find, that's why the first Aboriginal Australian poet, Kath Walker or Udguru Nunukal says, no, we are going. That's such a moving point. We are going. What is we are going? We are going means our customs, our value systems, our rituals, our community elders, our ceremonial elders, our earth elders, we are going. All the indigenous wisdom that comes along with us, we are going. Someone else is coming. So, the earth elders, right? Okay. Now, we have instances in the Indian context. I have the book with me. Maybe later also you can buy for yourself a must read. This is 2010, right? The first in India, Gray Areas, an anthology of Indian fiction on aging, an amazing book by Ira Raja. She's done some real, the introduction part is also so amazing. You should read it. It itself could be part prescribed as a chapter in itself. An amazing. And I'm just quoting from the blurb. I've just quoted there from the blurb to this book. For the first time, an extensive collection of writings on aging from a range of Indian languages, the stories, poems, and plays included here, not only illustrate the importance of narrative, we discussed narrative, the importance of narrative as a means of understanding the experience of growing old, but also the complex and contested nature of age as a category of identity, like race or gender, a class or community. Age also becomes a process or a category of identity. To Ira Raja, she's done some real extensive work, or I would say intensive work in the field, gray areas, look at that. Now, some terms for us in literary gerontology, some of the terms that you must have come across, this one is by Barbara Waxman, Reifeng's Roman, like the Bildung's Roman, Reifeng's Roman is inspired by, the term means novel of ripening. How you ripen towards death in a constructive, in a fruitful way, novels that deal with this process. Unlike the Bildung's Roman or the Kunstler Roman, Reifeng's Roman talks about novel of ripening, right? It's a story of ripening towards fruition. And the next word is ageism, like sexism or racism. This term was coined by Robert Butler in 1969. Stereotyping or discrimination against individuals or groups on the basis of their age. The most disheartening thing that happens in societies even today, we call it, the Spivakian word for that is othering, or the Gramscian word for that would be the subaltern, where they cannot speak for themselves. We objectify them by giving them a whole lot of negative, pejorative labels. What demeaning, shocking labels we have given them. When we want to scold a young boy or a girl also, we tell him, you are shaking like an old woman. What a disservice or disregard we do for the elderly when we compare a young boy or a girl to some of the natural normative weaknesses of old age. Talking and talking like an old lady, they will say. Or, perisal, right? They won't even call them using kind words, grandma or grandpa, tata or pati. They'll say perisal, kelvi. See the pejorative labels that associate or tag with them. And this is what is called ageism. Discrimination against individuals or groups on the basis of their age. Right? And how as literary souls, we should be sensitive of this fact. Even in cinema, you know, the main media, through which we communicate, we get our information, literature, right? Religion plays a vital role also, right? The media, the arts, paintings especially, depictions. As literary souls who are agents of transformation in society, we should be aware of these ways of seeing and try to reconstruct them in more engaging and fruitful and productive ways. So ageism is another word, like middlescence, like adolescence, no? Middlescence, Ray Funk's roman. Yeah. This is from the Middlescence Manifesto, Igniting the Passion of Midlife by Barbara Waxman, coined by Barbara Waxman again. Then anocriticism, like gynocriticism, from Elaine Showalter. You have anocriticism, an approach in age and aging studies, what it means to be aged by culture, cultural concept of aging. You know, in some universities, you'll find retirement age is 65. In some universities or colleges, you'll find retirement age is 62. In some private universities, the other day, I had the privilege of going to a private university. The HOD there is 75 years, and she's still so lively. The way she speaks literature, right? I even celebrated a photo of her with me on my status sometime back. The way she celebrates literature, I've never seen even youngsters do that. 75 and, celebrating literature, the joy of her life. So in some universities, it is 75. In some, it is 65. In some parts of India, it is 55. Some, it is 56. Some, it is 58, turning 60. So, aged by culture, how the concept of age is determined by culture, cultures determined by ideology. Raymond Williams calls it the dominant, emergent, and ideologies. Yeah. Then senescence, the process, the natural process or the biological process of growing old, biological aging. We call it atrophy, no? In philosophy, the word atrophy sometimes brings tears to your eyes. It says, anything born or anything that exists, it could be a vegetable or a flower. Today, it is so beautiful, a flower. You'll take your cameras with you and take as many clicks as possible and put it up on our status. But tomorrow, it is not the same flower. Because atrophy tells us that anything that grows and grows and grows will one day automatically have to fade and fade and dissolve. Human life summed up in the word atrophy. We grow as children. The first birthday, right, how grand they celebrate it. The first birthday of the child, or every birthday, the way we distribute chocolates. Have you ever seen a 60-year-old gentleman or a lady distributing chocolates like that? They would love to do that, you know that. They would love to celebrate their birthday. But maybe their kids didn't want that. They would say, let our youngsters do it. Maybe they want to celebrate their life with all their vigor. But maybe they are denied their voice, their agency. Literary gerontology looks at giving voice to the aged. Now, atrophy tells us that anything that goes up should come down. That is the way of life. Martin Heidegger says, no, we are beings in time. Beings in time. That is why he wrote 1927, Being and Time. I am a human being because I continue to exist, present continuous, in time. The moment I die, I become a dead body, not a human being. We carry two things within us all the time. One is life and the other is death. Both we equally carry with us throughout our existence. The more of life, the more we have lived, the more we are inching, That's why I've already quoted this, A famous actor from Tamil Nadu, he used to go to the Himalayas very often. We all know him. And when he was asked a question, a very philosophical answer he gave. You know, I go to the Himalayas for the simple reason that every day of my life, I see it as an incremental inching towards death, the only reality. Every one of us carry it with us. And that's why atrophy assumes a lot of significance. But how this incremental inching leads me or you or we or us towards self-fulfillment, that is the answer to the puzzle in gerontology. One more. Yeah, this is just quickly because these are examples that David Urban gives us, some amazing illustrations he gives in Eskimo. See the narratives of indigenous literatures. Hats off to them. In Eskimo legend, anyone who conspires to get rid of an old man meets with a terrible punishment. The tales are like that. The legends are constructed like that. Positive interventions on the elderly. You dare not do that to an elderly. If you ever try to get rid of an old person, you will meet with a terrible punishment. This concept is woven to the minds and the hearts of the little kids that they will always have a veneration for them as they grow up. No, don't talk bad about the elders. No. Why? Because Amma grew me up with a story that told me something beautiful about having elders around us. Appa told me a story that told me not to talk bad about elders. Always have the highest respect and regard for elders. So, in some tales, David Urban says, old people are powerful discoverers. You sit with an elderly person for 1 hour, you'll get the wisdom for an entire month's time. Healers or magicians, their chants and incantations are capable of bringing rain and shine, cure, and something that foretells the future. Their blessings, you know. And the singers, that's why we say, you know, folk tales also, you won't have the youngsters singing the songs, folk songs, the ballads. And even grandmas used to sing songs for us. No? The best singers in town are the grandmothers, obviously, not the grandfathers most of the time, because grandfathers don't exhibit the talent much, you see. So a singer has the greatest reputation only in their old age. The grandchildren are taught the art of warfare, cultivating the land, medicinal values, by who? Not the parents, but the grandparents. Where in Native American literatures, in indigenous literatures, in First Nations literatures, in, you know, tribal literatures. Right. Okay. Yeah, this is a story by Bertolt Brecht. See the title there, The Shameless Old Lady, because Simone de Beauvoir talks about how the woman in particular treats the last age as the real age of liberation. Free from the worries of the husbands, the nagging husbands. Free from the cares of the children, taking care of the children. Every hour, every minute. No, what does she need? What does he need? No worries. Now I'm liberated. The real age is the last age, the age of liberation. Simone de Beauvoir says in her wonderful treatise, 545 odd pages, coming of age. Right? All the lives they were subject to husbands, but now they are free. Now, this particular story by Bertolt Brecht, see the title, is a bit controversial, but The Shameless Old Lady, because the word shameless there could be critiqued. There is a lady, the protagonist, Madame Berthe, now 70 years old, recently widowed, just because she is free now. Earlier, she was under the clutches of her husband, very miserly. She couldn't spend anything she wanted. She always had to consult with the husband, and that the husband, like the Purple Rose of Cairo, no? You would have watched that movie, 1985 or 86, Purple Rose of Cairo, that Catherine Belsey talks about, where this lady fed up of her life, every evening she goes to the movies and watches the movies, and suddenly the hero from the screen jumps into real life and looks at this lady, and they both have a nice time together, like that. You know, here the old lady, the moment her husband passes away, she feels she's liberated from the clutches, the grips of her dominating husband. Now she has a whole lot of money on her. You know what she does? Like again, Fra Lippo from Lippi and Robert Browning, she mortgages all her belongings, her property. She resolves to paint the town red. She goes wherever she wants, wakes up, you know, deep into the night, walks wherever she wants, tastes the merriest of wines that she possibly could, because all these years she had to avoid wine. So, you know, and had a lot of fun. Then youngsters, some are jealous of her, some are talking bad of her. See this old lady, shameless old lady. All these years she was a very good, very docile lady. Now see the way she's celebrating her life. Spoiled old lady, shameless old lady. Society, the mirror. Now, in the last two lines, no? All the amusements that she yearns for, drinking red wine, seeing films, going to bed late, lying long into the morning, prefers to follow her own impulses. This is Bertolt Brecht, something that we can quickly. This is something I loved a lot by John Cooper Powys. It's a treatise on old age again. He says, one day as a little young boy, he was walking down the veranda, right? When he saw his grandfather sitting motionless on a sofa, the good old sofa, the easy chair, the reclining chair that grandfathers are traditionally associated with, you know, he was sitting there on his sofa, gazing at the evening lights and shadows. Now, grandfather feels very apologetic because he must have thought the little boy came longingly up to him, Pata, take me for a walk. Grandpa, take me somewhere with you, buy me candy bars. Maybe he thought like that. So the old man doesn't, you know, have the will and the wish to stand up now. He's just reclining gently and regally on his old sofa. Now, Johnny, before Johnny could ask him anything, the old man spontaneously says this. Remember, Johnny, my little boy, at my age, I can't do anything else. He says, at my age, I can't do anything else. Like the way you walk, the way you talk, the way you dance, I can't do that. Now, John Cooper Powys, the little boy, thinks about this sentence, this statement that his grandpa told him. At my age, I can't do anything else. There is a kind of eureka moment that happens to this young boy. You know what he says? The old person has a right to inactivity. For the first time in his life, he has no more duties. We say, no, the moment a person turns 3, the first baggage comes at the back, the drooping bag and baggage filled with homework, the school bag comes latched to the shoulders of the little girl. And from then on, no turning back. One day you can't avail yourself a holiday. That's why children celebrate when there is a holiday, because from then on, no free time, only spare time. Spare time is time that you get between your busy schedules. So the child, from 3 years onwards, till the time she grows up, you know, we call it rites of passage, no? Every event of her life is marked in time. One wrong entry in our +2 mark sheet or marks about her date of birth, immediately we'll fight. In our, you know, mark sheets or transfer certificates, we'll find the year of birth, the date of birth is marked. Right from then, till the rites of passage we have in our lives. We finish 10th standard, we celebrate. We finish 12th standard, we exult. We finish UG, we have a hood on us. We take selfies, post it up on Instagram or Facebook. We finish PG, then we go for a work. We give the first salary to mom. Life goes on, goes on, goes on. Every day filled with commitments, added commitments, extra commitments, brahmacharyam, grihastham, vanam, sannyasam. The last part is sannyasam. In brahmacharyam, you can't think about sannyasam. In graham, you can't think about sannyasam. The last part is his right to enjoy or celebrate his inactivity, because all these years, he had a lot of commitments, which he dispensed with the best possible care and guidance. So now, this little boy has a transformative way of seeing. Perspective has changed. At last, no more duties. Peace at last. The rules no longer apply. Now is the time for my grandfather to celebrate his inactivity. And how dare I disturb it? I will respect his right to inactivity and make sure he celebrates his right to inactivity in whatever way he wills it to. That is, you know, Bowie's perspective on his own grandfather that he writes there, right? Now, the most memorable line that I could ever quote when I end a lecture would be Benokri, one of my favorites. He says, how can I bring about a transformation in ways of seeing, in perspectives? He says, we are storied beings. We live stories that either give our lives meaning or negate it to meaninglessness. Change the stories, change lives, he says. When you change the stories, we can change perspectives. We can change ways of seeing and bring about a real transformation. And that would be the ultimate solution or the ultimate reward we give in this field, engaging field of literary gerontology. Thank you so much.
Wow. Thank you so much, sir, for that wonderful lecture. We had all come to listen to you speak about literary gerontology, but you treated us to, you know, a real cornucopia again, a plenty of topics you touched, you know, without losing the focus. You spoke about memory studies, psychology, critical theory, you know, medicine, everything, you know, and chronologically and across cultures. You gave us, in 1.5 hours, you gave us a mind-blowing introduction to literary gerontology. And we are very grateful, sir. Thank you so much.
One minute, sister. Please, all the members, give big thunder claps to sir. Excellent lectures. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much.
Sir, we are truly nurtured by your delightful deliberations. There are a lot of comments in the chat box by appreciating the talk. And Mr. Ravichi Krishna, he has posted in the YouTube chat box that Dr. Rufus classes are totally new learnings. So blessed to listen to you, sir. And another one like Vidyar Das, he says, excellent presentation, sir. And the security and principal also have provided their part of appreciation in the chat box.
Thank you, especially to Dr. Avichi Krishnan. Thank you, Dr. Das. Yes, thank you, everyone. Thank you so much. You really made my day. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
If there are any questions anyone would like to ask Dr. Rufus, it can be raised now. So there's like so much of appreciation. There's no way we can finish reading all that. So we will try to record it and send it to you, sir.
Yes. Thank you, sir.
Can I ask a question?
Yes.
Ma'am, please go ahead. I'm very thankful to Rufus, sir. Especially for myself, I am a researcher in literary gerontology, and I am very, very much thankful to the organizing committee of this institution that you organized a lecture on literary gerontology, so that it is very enriching for researchers in this field. So I have it.
Yes, ma'am, you can go ahead. Yeah.
Shall I say a word, Angeline?
Yes, sister.
Okay. Dear Professor Samuel, your lecture was so lively, so inspiring and influencing. A very wonderful lecture. Thank you so much, sir, for accepting our invitation and make this seminar a grand success webinar. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. And I appreciate all the professors of English departments for organizing such a wonderful webinar. Congratulations to you all.
Congratulations to the organizers and Dr. Samuel Rupas, sir, for opening a new literary literary concept and taking us into a very interesting way.
Thank you.
Hello. Yes, ma'am. Shall I ask?
Yes, ma'am. Kindly go ahead.
Okay. My name is Hema. Rufus, sir, can we consider critical gerontology as a new way of analyzing?
Ma'am, I couldn't hear you clearly.
Ma'am, she seems to be having some signal problems. Like,
She said, you know, can we consider critical gerontology as a new way of, she said, after that, I can't.
After that, I think she's left the meeting, sir. She seems to be having some problem.
Sir, I'm having some problem with my connection.
Yes, you may go.
Okay, sir. Can we consider literary gerontology as a new way of analyzing literary texts?
Yes, good question. Very good question. Yes. As a very new way of, that's why, you know, literary gerontology wants to give us a new aesthetic in itself, not the old aesthetic. It's a new way, a new perspective of seeing, you know, of, I would use the word engaging with literary texts, right? And in postmodern parlance, post-structuralist parlance, a text could be anything. It could be art, it could be your grocery bill, it could be anything. A new way of engaging with literary texts or texts in general. Yes. It is a new way. Yes.
Excuse me, sir.
Yes.
Ma'am. Sir, I am Tirumalai Raja.
Yes, please go ahead, sir. Yes.
Sir, thank you so much for the wonderful session, sir.
Thank you.
From your presentation, I choose the word constructed. Really, you constructed the session, sir. Superb session. And I am crossing my 30s and I am feeling that aging is a wonderful thing after your presentation. Super, sir. I love my aging. We have to love, we have to analyze our aging factor. Thank you so much for this fantastic session, sir. And thank you so much for the organizers, conveners. Thank you. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you so much.
Really wonderful session, sir. Thank you so much.
I would just add to what he has said. Not only loving aging, but also celebrating our aging, right? That celebration is also...
Sure, sir.
Thank you.
Professor, I have one more. Can you suggest me some texts that I should read to get some insights on critical gerontology?
Yes, there are a lot of texts. Maybe I can immediately, after this talk is over, I can hand over a list of books. There are a variety of books. I can hand over a list of them to the organizers. They can pass it on to you.
Can you give me your contact number so that I can contact you later?
Yes. Maybe I can.
Will you please, sir?
Yes. I can maybe drop it up in the chat box here. I'll put it up here. You can. Yeah.
Okay, sir. Thank you very much.
Most welcome. Yeah.
And sir, there are a couple of more questions in the chat box. Would you like to take them, sir?
Yes, please, yeah. Please. Yes.
And, if anyone needs the contact address or details of sir, they can contact us and that can be sent to the people who are interested. Thank you. So the questions, sir, would you please share your perspective on the scope of gerontology in Indian mythology? It's a question by Ms. Valarmathi Suresh.
Yes, very, very good question. Actually, this book that I've told you, know, by Ira Raja, also gives us some clues and answers to that, because it's a very engaging, you know, and rewarding field also, because Indian mythology, as I've told you earlier, mythology helps us construct perspectives of aging. And so there are a lot of positive constructs, at the same time a few negative constructs also. And you know, the way we engage, this book by Ira Raja would give us some interesting clues to that. Please read this. And if more is needed on the subject, I can pass it on to you through the organizers. Thank you. Thank you for that question.
Thank you, sir. There's one more. Sir, could you please share your view on Maroka and Lion and the Jewel?
I can't get it.
That is the question there, sir. Ms. Paulin Jivita wants to know if what you think about the character Baroka from Lion and the Jewel.
The Lion and the Jewel. No, I haven't read it. So I haven't read it. So I'm not able to give my comments on that. I'm so sorry. Right? I should have read it to give you my observations. Yeah.
Thank you, sir. Yeah. Are there any more questions? Any other questions? And we also sincerely thank Professor Avachi Krishnan, who also gave a lot of extra inputs to, you know, in YouTube. He was giving a lot of names of authors and books
that
go with the topic sir was talking about. So we thank you, sir. Yes, ma'am.
Thank you, Avachi, sir. Thank you, Avachi, sir.
So are there any more questions?
Yes, especially researchers, if you have any
questions. Sir. Yeah.
Yes.
Your lecture was very useful, and I had one question. I have a doubt. How we compare and study the difference in literature of 19th century or Middle English, how we compare, it's very vast. How we compare shortly, and how we study for a timing occurrence?
Yeah, between the literatures of two centuries, right? It's next to impossible, yeah. Right? It's next to impossible, but you can just give your perspectives from representative examples. That's it. You can't do a panoramic. Harold Bloom has written hundreds of books. He himself admits that, you know, I am not an authority. So you can't do a huge objective study. It's next to impossible. But what you can possibly do is take representative samples from the age and then try to compare it. And the narrower or the limited your representative examples are, the better. You know, that's what we tell researchers. Make it so narrow. Make it so narrow so that you can be specialist, right? If I go to a sweet shop and I see a whole lot of sweets, gulab jamun, jalebi, Mysore pak, I can't be an expert in all the sweets there. But I can choose one Mysore pak or one gulab jamun, and I can do research on that, and I can be an expert in gulab jamuns. Whenever someone asks me about gulab jamuns, I can give right from the origin till today's relevance in the present context. So narrowing down is all the more important, and that is why representative samples from ages. You can't do justice because new historicists would have us believe that it is next to impossible, right? So maybe representative samples you can give, and from your perspective alone you can say it. Nothing is objective, right? In literature, theory would have us believe we are all subjects to ideologies, so it cannot be objective, but you can try to give your perspective to your understanding of a comparative study, like Shakespeare and Kalidasa.
Thank you, sir.
Yes, welcome.
So there's one more question. We'll take one more question. This is from Mr. Uday Kumar, who wants to know your opinion on W.B. Yeats's The Byzantium from the gerontological point of view.
Yes, actually, very good question, because W.B. Yeats was obsessed with the concept of old age. Like I told you about many of these 19th and 20th century writers, they were obsessed with the concept. If you look at this, you know, there is an encyclopedia called the Gale's Encyclopedia, where you have a special section exclusively denoted to how Yeats was obsessed with the concept of old age. That's why sailing becomes a metaphor. The sailing to Byzantium becomes a metaphor. Sailing becomes a metaphor. Right, it is a journey, it is a voyage, right? So not only sailing to Byzantium, but other poems also, you'll find there is a kind of gerontological slant and a nostalgic remembrances also, right, in his poetry. Yes, I would suggest this book for you, Gale's Encyclopedia, G-A-L-E, right? Gale's Encyclopedia. It is available in our college library. It's huge, mammoth one, A to Z, that specially focuses on the old age, gerontology, W.B. Yeats, and some of these select poems. Good. Thank you. Thank you for that question.
Okay. So do you think we have time for one more question?
Yes.
Okay, sir. So
There's someone who asked me to repeat the name of the book, Gale, G-A-L-E, Gale. Gale's Encyclopedia, right? Yeah, Gale's Encyclopedia. I think, you know, this book would also help you in clearing your net if you are writing your, taking your net, right? Wonderful, amazing book. Authentic information you get. Please don't refer to Wikipedia, right, for authentic information when it comes to research. One thing that we always tell our scholars, the last resort for you as a research scholar should be to quote from Wikipedia, right? It's good, no doubt, but again, right, it has its own inadequacies because it is anyone can edit it, user edit is there, right? So
okay. So the last question of the session, sir. Can we Dr. Sumati wants to know, can we connect literary gerontology to Candace Abelton's speech by Spivak, sir?
Why not? Yes, there is rich possibility. Subaltern here, when you try to analyze a character from literature as a subaltern, as a person who cannot speak because of their age or age-related factors, they are completely sidelined or present in oblivion. Yes, ma'am, definitely yes. You can do that. And someone has asked, you know, about Rip Van Winkle and gerontology. Yes, interesting. You know, case studies you can do. Sir, can we compare and study Rip Van Winkle and gerontology? Yes, I would say that would be a very delightful study, right? And the Rip Van Winklish sleep, you call it. The sleep there becomes a metaphor. So it would be a real interesting study. If you are doing such a study, please contact me also. I will try to give my inputs.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you so much, sir, for making the question and answer session so engaging. And now I call upon Mrs. Yu Anamika, the organizing secretary of the webinar, to propose the vote of thanks.
And there are some questions. Maybe I can take it later because of lack of time. Ms. Monica has asked a wonderful question. Okay. Thank you so much.
We can take it, sir. Maybe we can take the question.
I think it's okay, sir.
You know, because she said, I have a question, sir. I just want to know the state of gerontophobia in non-Western literature. I agree the proportion is high in Western literature. It is it not generally prevailing in in non-Western literature? Yes. Right? The proportion is high, but we can't essentialize again. Very good question, ma'am. You can't essentialize at all. That's why I was very particular in telling you that Kathleen Woodward and my other writer, Simone de Beauvoir, are my choices there because they are celebrated, right, in their respective fields. But again, it's a very interesting point of view that you raised. You can't essentialize, you can't totalize by saying, you know, there are instances where they provide care for the elderly in Western cultures that is not there in some other cultures, right, that we can learn from, possibly from them. Yes, very insightful. True, very true.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for the explanation. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening. It gives me immense pleasure to propose vote of thanks on this significant occasion. Philippians 2:13 says, for it is God who works in you both to will and to do for his good pleasure. First and foremost, I thank the Lord Almighty, who is the initiator of life in the earth, whose powerful hand has brought us to the closure of the program. I'm honored and privileged to thank Dr. Rufus, Associate Professor and Dean of Students, Madras Christian College, Chennai, for his reflections on an important and rarely discussed topic, the emerging social conditions left the youngsters by concentrating more on building their career rather than devoting on elders, who has paved way for them. This webinar would be of a great source of wisdom for us to ponder over the proverb from the Bible, which rightly says that the silver-haired head is a crown of glory if it is found in the way of righteousness. It is indeed, the talk was bubbly with compassion and empathy. Your talk is indeed a treasure chest for us, sir. Thank you. On behalf of the management department and on my own behalf, I thank you, sir, for all the inputs you have imprinted in our mind. It's my bound duty to thank our secretary and principal for their support in all our undertakings. I take great pleasure in thanking our head of the department, Dr. Patricia Alfa Nimla, whose unwavering efforts and meticulous planning have made all things possible. I feel happy to thank Mrs. Angeline Sarna, coordinator of the webinar series, and the convener of the webinar for her strenuous efforts in coordinating everything and everyone together. Then I thank all the participants for their enthusiastic and passionate interest in literature, which have made this webinar a momentous one. They have made the question answer session lively and more reflective. I'm grateful to all the colleagues of our Department of English for their happy togetherness. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. And thank you, dear participants, for your enthusiastic involvement. We request you to kindly fill up the feedback form to get your e-certificates. And hope to meet you all again on the 22nd evening for the second lecture of the webinar series. Thank you.
Thank you. Congratulations.
Thank you, sister. Thank you so much, sir, for joining us and your time. Thank you.